until now you have listened to some remarkable ideas about the history of the 20th century urban history in Spain, also environmental history, etc. But what I'm going to present now is some ideas and some personal reflections on urban planning history in Spain, or the history of contemporary urbanism. That is from 1920s up until now, not exactly 20th century, but 100 years of urbanism. So it seems to me more clear and complete. 100 years sounds better. Of course, I will try to explain the evolution of urban planning in 100 years. My intention here is just to make some reflections on the Spanish urban planning history, pointing out what we consider an important issue, its relationship with urban forms. And the first hypothesis is that there is still some confusion with when dealing on this very complex process and issue. So we need to consider some theoretical issues before going to the Spanish urban planning history. Because as an English geographer say, Peter Lahan, this planning history it seems a broad church with historians, geographers, architects and urban morphologists. So let's say something about morphologies, permanence, innovation, the specificity of Spanish urban planning. It seems clear that modern urban planning arrived later in Spain than in other European countries, Germany, France, or UK, Britain. So, due to several circumstances, Spain now, the slow process of industrialization. The paradox is that Spain had been in the foreground in the 19th century with Cerdá extension plan for Barcelona and his theory of urbanization published in 1867. Oscar Jurgens, in this very important book published in 1926, Spanish cities, he says, curiously, whereas in other countries the active intellectual movement was introduced from that moment in all areas of Spain, that at the beginning had been in the foreground, stayed backwards. It is curious to see how this process also happens in other periods of time, but now in the view of Peter Hall in the United Kingdom, when he says, whereas once the UK led the world in urban design and creative approaches to planning, more recently the UK has gone backwards. British planners have lost the art of urbanism. That was the last book by Peter Hall. See these better lives. Of course, by thinking on the intellectual history of planning and design, as the title of this famous book by Peter Hall says, it seems appropriate to consider the work and views of this very important author, or some of the best planning historians. Stephen Ward, for instance, said this. Just two quotations. The first one is at the end of the book of Cities of Tomorrow. It says, one central thesis of this book is that perhaps we came back full circle. At the end of nearly a century of modern planning, the problems of cities remain much as they have been at the start, not precisely so, of course. Then the other book says, how can we all relearn the lost art of urbanism? А тоа е Сатлив, но планин историја, економика, социјал историја. First in a short essay of the same year, Sutcliffe managed to relate paradigms to economic cycles and building blocks. According to him, in times of growth or upswing, planning is ambitious, innovative, exciting to execute. In these periods, large-scale projects are the key. During the downturns, in times of recession, planning is somewhat deceptive in execution, but induce a new generation of creative ideologies and artists to prepare the way for a new stage of growth. When this happens, small urban projects are more relevant. Here's a very interesting essay and very interesting the idea, because all this led us to the already classical thesis of Hans Schachery with her well-known dual model on progressive versus capitalist urbanism, something that we could also call town planning versus urbanism or urbanistic or urbanismo, in the words of Michael Herr. And this way we can have a short view on different generations of different cycles of plans and projects in the Spanish cities. Generally speaking, we realize that the split between planning and urban design now has its correspondence in planning history and on one side, and the history of urbanism and urban design on the other hand. There are many works on planning history in the last decades, a lot of books, papers, etc. First, all some examples from Hall to Peter Paul to Stephen Wall to a lot of articles in more than 30 years of the magazine Planning Perspectives to the handbook of the Rowley's Handbook of Planning History. We can find the different stories of this handbook. But it is not so easy to find this in conventional planning history, even in the book of Peter Paul is a really ambitious one with his aim of dealing with both the intellectual history of planning and design. At the same time, there has been a lot of research on the history of urbanism or urbanistica or urbanismo. You could say that historia de urbanistica, obviously, not exactly the same as planning history with this. Or Vittorio Emanuele Napugnani, the history of the city, and focus on urban forms, or urban forms that Panagian authors in French, or for Invoco Urbanism, in this, with this idea of focusing on urban forms, but also with the aim of looking to planning history. Because this, of this split, we have some difficulties when dealing with both dimensions of urban planning and urbanism. We could say that our approach tries to follow this planning and morphological perspective. With all this in mind, we can identify three periods that will help us to talk about some issues regarding the predominance of different paradigms and urban visions, from urbanism to planning to urban projects. The first one will be from 1920s to 1940s, where we can talk about the emergence of institutionalization, the first model of urban planning. According to Fernando Terán, this could be named an urbanism of layouts, and extension planning, because these are the characteristics of the most of the plans and projects of this time. City beautiful schemes and extension plan. Second, the second one will be from after the war, especially from the 1950s to 1970s, which is a sort of planning for urban growth. This was the period when planning in Spain with a more functionalist plans, forming plans, more abstract with not much concern about run forms. And finally, the third period will last from 1980s onward, a period when we can see a radical shift to a sort of reformist planning, which was also somehow paradoxically renovated more ecological urbanism. Then in recent years, despite the housing bubble of 1997-2008, we see some continuity and consistency of this technocratic planning on one side and strategic and landscape urbanism on the other. This way we could share the idea of the first two periods with Fernando Terán. We are going to talk about this. And as Julian and others say, modern than later in Spain, but however, this delay, of course, in the emergence of the modern discipline on urban planning didn't prevent from international transfer and disciplinary interchanges. For instance, following the French tradition, some Beaux-Arts plans were developed in several Spanish cities. They were made in correspondence with the opening of the grandes vías, almost all the Spanish cities, monumental urban spaces, always echoing the Paris model and the city beautiful movement. In Barcelona, the case of the Josselin Plan, 1907, 1910, is an exceptional example that is careful reading, but now just like to say that despite its large scale, it shows a sort of artistic urbanism, not only as a reaction to the monotony of Cerdà and Sánchez, Cerdà extension, but also as a way of introducing some formalist concepts together with functionalist components zoning associated to the French School of Urbanism. The exhibition, the warfare of 1929 in Barcelona was another episode that we could see in this perspective of city beautification. In any case, the urbanism of layouts was the main paradigm, and the relative efficient one in this period. Urban reforms and urbanization always part of this explanation of the becoming, as literally say in Barcelona, the Paris of the South, as in other cities in the world. It is true that, of course, that there were another 1930s, Republican years, some innovative urban proposals, but real urbanism followed the urbanism of layouts. We can make reference to the modern urbanism of urban housing in Spain before the Civil War. The most known, most discussed one was Gran Masia with Corbusier and Serre and Spanish and Catalan architects in collaboration. But and also some experiments that are very interesting and important on a smaller scale, the Casa Block, super block by itself, that's built in Barcelona. But this was the exception. The main strategy way of station was with this appearance of layout and station plan. It was not so different in the case of Madrid, despite some differences in both cities. It became clear that at the beginning of the century, 1920s, 1930s, it became clear that the 19th century plan de ensanche, Castro, plan was efficient just in the central areas in the first part of the ensanche. However, real urban growth away from this central ensanche area differ drastically from what was planned. The planning of Madrid has been dominated since the middle of the 19th century by this Plan Castro, but what had been done was in many ways in contradiction with the original plan out of this central area. At the same time, there were some important urban interventions, of course, such as the opening of the Gran Vía, again, a sort of urban city beautification strategy, parallel to the phenomenon of the city beautiful plans and projects in many European cities. As in other cities, we can see Madrid some modern plans, even modernist plans and projects in 1920s, 1930s. They could have formal visions and functional principles were synthesized and applied to the specific Spanish urban planning conditions and traditions. Remarkable, for instance, is the collaboration between Suazo, an important Spanish architect planner, with Thomas Janssen, the German planner, in the important international competition for the Madrid Extension Plan, 1929. This is an example of the state-level influence and the advent of modernist urban planning in Spain. This Suazo Janssen plan incorporated international modern functionalist urban tenets without overlooking to take a special care to specific urban conditions. That actually, in spite of this mentality, it could be seen as more, maybe more modern system than the scheme that the Plan Macià in Barcelona. But real urban growth was not following this way. And also, Secondino Suazo, this important Spanish urban planner, was the author of urban design projects for the interior, inner redevelopment and expansion of Sevilla, Bilbao, Zaragoza, among other cities. All of them were proposals of very indisputable originality and invention, with the convention even of the European city, for instance in Zaragoza, this partial urban extension plan, again by Suazo, was like a change at the end of the 30s, and it's worth pointing out that formal layouts combined with this hierarchical and functional system of avenues and streets with diversity of blocks. So this was another paradigmatic example of urbanism of a sort of urbanism based on international functionalist urban tenets, especially borrowed from the different European traditional schools, such as the Black Amsterdam Street project, for instance, as directly modeled. Therefore, we can find some specificity in the plans of this period in Spanish cities, as they were innovative proposals. But the truth is that they were paradigmatic examples of a way of understanding the lines in Europe, influenced these schools. The plans of the extension plans were blueprint plans that provided a physical framework for development of the central and first periphery, but outside these areas, and away of the essentially development that took place often for last grade from that specified respective task. We now turn to the second period that we have called planning for urban growth and development from 1950s and 1960s. For this city, for these times. For some, this was also in Europe the golden age of planning, but it seems to have become consolidated during this economic upswing period. The great boom of the 1950s, 1960s, that lasted until the oil crisis of 1973. In this period of spectacular urban growth, in the post-war, the key legislation was the 1956 Urban Land Act legislation. The Suelo or the Land Act was for several decades the basic framework for regulating urban development. But despite of the general failure to control the urban development, the issue here is that we see the shift of this urban supplier to a more comprehensive idea of the plan as a global provision for urban growth. Just an image to remark the power of some mayors that under Franco dictatorship were designated directly by the head of state of the dictator. It's worth to say that the role has been not so well studied by urban historiography. Listen, the case of Barcelona, Mayor Josep Porcioles according to several sources and Lawrence stories, among others, activated the city by corruption, speculation, and some bad interventions. But it's so important that many people, books about the Barcelona in this period, as the Barcelona Porciones. Barcelona was the city of the mayor, was very powerful, with some technicians who work in tandem. But a very interesting issue that I think there are many aspects still open when dealing with the role of different agents living in this period. So it's not only developers, there are politicians, but of course technicians, architects and planners. So if we want to know what happened from the inside, I think we should follow the important book by Fernando Vera. Yeah, many other articles and works and researches, but this one I think is so important, published in 1978. Actually, it's still the main reference, as there have important roles in the Spanish urban planning administration, and was an exceptional witness and player, especially as regards to urban planning in Spain in all these periods. I think it is up until the 1970s. It provides a particular view of the models of international urban planning culture, and notably of the special mechanisms that were employed during this period of study. Serrat presents this period as a sad history of three, not just this period, from the beginnings of the century, the first tense of the modern urban planning, a sad history of three quarters of a century, from the promising beginnings of the turn of the 20th century to the end of the Franco dictatorship in 1975. I think it's very interesting because, among all the things, it also concludes a very scrupulous and thorough study with a clearly negative assessment of that impossible plan. So that's the title of the book, is Urban Planning, History of an Impossible Plan, Possible Process. Because, just because it is straight from the global models of international urban planning culture, but rather because of the important technocratic manners that characterize the response made by Spanish urban planning. It says that the evident continuity and persistence of a few basic planning models, which remain practically unchanged for practically the entire process, without appearing affected other than superficially by variation in specific historical situations. But in other words, Serrano was able to be particularly critical of the attempts to create a scientific urbanism, a constant aspiration since the beginning of the 20th century, which is the greatest development in the 1960s with the conceptualization, institutionalization, systematization of this kind of scientific plan. If we have a look at this very interesting diagrams made by Terán, he compares the model of urban growth. This is the Land Planning Act of 1966 and the real model of urban growth. This diagram, we have the same in another version, this English version, we can see the first one synthesized the idea of the Land Act, a model of urban growth in which the sprawl of the central core was arrested and the new development, careful plan and control through the local plan mechanism would be placed with these urban reserve areas, lines surrounding the central core. As regard to the local plan level, the Land Act laid particular emphasis on the state as a major state of polygono, it's a major morphological form of peripheral growth. And these local level planning instruments and regulations were often used in the bargaining process between developer and council. The second one, the second diagram, shows the model of real city growth in which the housing estates and shanty towns were often built on land classified as urban reserve and or rural land. Besides this, there was a process of increasing, of course, building densities in the center of urban land, resulting in congestion and overcrowding. So, the feeling of urban core, especially along the main roads and infrastructures, anarchical sprawl in the periphery, controverting planning regulation and land use classifications, the resultant urban growth processes was a piecemeal, somehow anarchic sprawl in the city periphery. Of course, it's not so easy to generalize, but we could still look to some cities under plan to see that the story was about the same almost everywhere. Regarding post-modernism, you can realize, of course, there were some attempts from the new fascist regime, and some elements of the idea of the financial city, especially in the capital in Madrid, the fachada, the sky of Manzanares. It's sort of very interesting, the idea of the new capital with the Royal Plaza, great avenues, the Via de la Victoria, but this was very marginal because, yes, in the 1941 and 1940s, the plan, the general plan for Madrid was approved. It was essentially a continuation of the 1929 1931 plans for the capital. The plan is reminiscent of many of the other international ideas, or Saarinen, or other proposals for organic decentralization, had much in common, for instance, with Abercrombie's London Plan, approved in 1944, and other plans. All this is much known, and it was analyzed in deep in this work by Tera. As in other cities, the big shift came in the 1960s, when a new generation of cycle of plans arrived. No as development plan, planes del desarrollismo, so this time of great, as a reply to the rapid urban growth. The Sinalton planning from the metropolitan area, for instance, is a clear example for the new economic cycle led to this optimistic plans for great developments. This geological produce a growing distance with from the formal dimension of urban spaces and less concern for urban forms. So there were, of course, some experimental and interesting examples of housing estates which have been classified in Dofo Momo, in documents of modern movements, of course. The truth is that most of them have lower quality these years. There were, of course, plans for sectors, partial plans for polygons, for these mass housing estates, and they work as useful tools for also for speculation, since they allow increasing building levels, they include this process of not so anarchical but very low quality extension in the new peripheries. Despite this poor results of these polygons, these housing estates, because of the generally low quality of the building, but also the farmless open spaces, the lack of integration in the city, it is questionable if they were worse or not than the urban landscape of the ordinary peripheries. You can see here this spectacular contrast with the ordinary peripheries. Sometimes self-construction, sometimes traditional building with roads and blocks, and this contrast with these modern peripheries. In Barcelona, the process was not so different. Of course, there were another type of plan for Mallorca. It's been really studied indeed. The plan for Mallorca, regional plan of 1953, very interesting, based for new extensions, but the beginnings were people working with a lot of efforts were made for to carefully control urban growth. However, as in other Spanish cities, those plans, at the end, the story increased densities without corresponding provision of public facilities, at times preempted spaces dedicated to these facilities, even approving a lot of housing estates without preliminary partial local planning, even if it was an advanced culture of urban planning and urban design. As you can see, this not just the general plan level, but also this lower local level with this partial plans and with professionals, architects working. And as happened in Madrid, the early polygons of Vienna in the 1950s were more experimental, more attentive to urban design in the 40s and 50s, but this gave way to, as an author who has studied for many years the process in Barcelona, he said this gave way to an avalanche of low quality architectural projects that characterized a large part of the 1960s and 1970s modern projects. Despite the effort of local planning, the certain urban growth process was again almost the same as in Madrid. Like you got sprawl in the peripheries, of course, happens in Madrid, some of those polygons have improved in the last decades and all the cities because of the infrastructures and amenities later, and because now they are not so isolated as they used to be, and some of them have been upgraded and generated and improved. But in order to Valencia, all those urban processes happen in one way or another in most medium-sized cities. There were not so many comparatives that, but we could see the problems. For instance, in Valencia, local conditions, a lot of also in Zaragoza, when the plan of 1957 became very soon obsolete and led to a new plan of 1968, absolutely different, with much more ambitious goals. Also in this case, the focus on zoning the urban structure contrasts with the low attention paid to parcel plans, which were sold more following quantitative parameters, housing densities, standard for facilities, etc. In this case, it's worth to mention the important urgent development project of Tour, which was approved just after this general plan. As in Madrid, in Tres Cantos, Zaragoza, Tour, and Vitoria, Tour, this urgent development project for about 100,000 inhabitants was approved, was built just after the general plan in 1971, a sort of large scale mass housing estate that was built during the following decades. Parallels are clear, of course, if we look to Valladolid plans and the impact on the urban growth, the excellent work and exhibition in the last 50 years, urban development shows similar roles and impact of plans. This, the result of urban growth process was one of medium to low quality of housing estates and is like the exploring purposes in the building. So, not exactly the same story, but almost the same. Regarding the legacy of some of those residential landscape built in that period, there's an interesting debate on the values and processes of obsolescence that they have suffered in the last 50 years. We wonder up to what extent they were the result of the strategies of developers and the economic circumstances in a period of extraordinary and accelerated urban growth, or to what extent they were also a product of the modernist and some consumerist conception, the as Peter Hall said, the Corbusier legacy, codified in the Athens Charters already in the 1930s, but applied almost 30 years later. And that happens in many cities, and especially in Spanish cities. Anyway, we know that it was a complex process that is still open to new comparative studies, which we think are very, very important in order to understand what happened in Spanish history. Then, the impact of some of those plans of the second period could have been positive in some cases, since they had to structure urban growth. However, controlling urban forms was another issue that required a higher degree of integration of the various scales of the project. On the contrary, this period, the second period, this association between comprehensive plans and urban projects that demanded more attention for layouts and architecture was lasting. In a sense, the impossibility of planning in the walls of Tehran gave way to other visions in the following period. So, all these last period reformist plans and morphological urbans, if we think about the planning and strategic urbans. Also here, this process is well known, the process of change that this sort of conventional planning gave way to this type of planning, then to quality renaissance period of transition to democracy. But the time of the first municipal election in 1979, of course, as we explained now, there was a widespread public demand for measures to stop the erosion of urban quarters and the sprawl. And we can see the most important and radical changes, new renovated plans were categorized by what Campos Benítez called the third generation plans. They will follow the first generation of reconstruction plan after the war, the second plan for urban growth, which was the speculative plan, and about the third generation. The curious is just that on one hand, we first had, especially in Barcelona, but also in other cities, the name was the remedy plans, the plan of remediales, remedy. And then this led to the most elaborated reference plans of the 1980s. On the other hand, they were also called morphologist plans, something that we also understood as quality urbanism. This is an interesting debate, since both perspectives are important and right. First, there was an extraordinary historical context with a big economic recession of the mid-1970s, and second, the transition to democracy, and therefore the starting point was a strong critique to the disasters of the early urban processes on the inefficiency of the conventional zoning plans. Then, the need of a powerful urban policy which should address all the deficits inherited. And this wasn't done with the leadership of social movements and leftist parties. The general plan for Madrid of 1985 was the model of all plans, model of all plans, Saddam Hussein said. Yes. It was so important that was the first successful slogan, Recuperar Madrid, recovering Madrid. We will say was a slight difference in Barcelona. It was the reconstrucción de Barcelona, reconstruction of Barcelona in line with the European reconstruction of the city discourse. That is addressing the imbalance of social geography with a progressive strategy toward this goal. This way, the plan was called as a tool for projects of intervention, instead of thinking on the zoning system as the only instrument. But besides this, there was a clear emphasis on urban form. starting with a famous work called 50 Ideas. 50 Ideas as a sort of applied research in urban architecture. And it was part of an increasing morphological understanding of urban growth. Urban form was explicitly mentioned as the subject of the plan. The emergence of urban projects was parallel to those urban planning concepts. Therefore, we can consider that this was a design-oriented and also an strategic approach to urban planning associated to social and economic goals. The impact of this plan and other cities of the same generation made a lot of them in the middle of the 1980s was really important. They activated a relevant process of urban improvement and regeneration of the extensive peripheries, including also detailed urban projects. It may be said that the intense transformation that has really changed the shape of Madrid and also most Spanish cities in the 1980s up to the crisis of 2008 has been the result of numerous planned interventions, often consisting in large-scale projects which were responsible for the general improvements to cities, especially in some peripheries. In this disciplinary context, there was the shift from the city of blocks to the city of the new urban blocks. The new urban extensions, or new instances, especially in Madrid, are called, recover the morphology of the traditional urban block with avenues and squares, even if they lack the urban intensity, of course, of the old 19th century city extension. Despite the similarities of the layout, it's another issue that is very interesting to see how we can understand that there's a lot of experimentation and lot of improvements in the quality of the peripheries comparing with the city of blocks of the early period, but also with some obvious limits regarding urban intensity and urban life. Then we have the recent story, very known, of the housing bubble of the end of the 1990s and the beginnings of the new millennium until the crisis of 2008. That is really another issue, even if we now can understand better what happened in early bubbles, such as the one in the 1960s up until the beginning of the 70s, looking from the perspective of what has happened in the last years. Well, in Barcelona, even if planning strategies were no so different, in Barcelona the remedy plans were conceived and implemented in this slightly different way, because there was first this plan, the general metropolitan plan approved in 1976, which is still the vision, is the valid plan now. It was the main basis for all developing urban projects since this moment, since the 1980s up until now. Within the frame of the 1992 Olympic Games, the project changed from small piecemeal interventions in the 1980s to large-scale urban projects in the 1990s. It is meaningful to the way Barcelona's awareness was awarded the prestigious gold medal by the Royal Institute of British Architects. Then, Pascual is a little mistake, it's with U, not with C, Pascual. Pascual Alvarez, the mayor, of course, with Boigas and other architects. Tandem, which was the first time in London in this very important award, that was awarded to a city, not to an architect. So they were three mayors and three architects to get the prize. But was, and then Malaga said, and it's very interesting in the book of Thomas and Urban Renaissance, was very important for the UK, but he was invited to write the foreword, and he says the trick The trick was quality first, quantity after. And this very is not just a slogan. I think it's very, very interesting because prior to this, in 1987, the city had received the Harvard Prize for its good design. But, however, the River Royal Gold Medal for Architecture in 1999 was given to the politician and professional architects of the City Council for their commitment to planning, including the combination of spectacular urban projects and of small-scale improvements of squares and streets. And we said at the end that Peter Paul was very interested in this issue, and therefore the small-scale operations related to public open spaces were highlighted as much as the largest strategic urban projects, representing two types of urban planning interventions associated with corresponding periods of city renewal. It was the book by Oriol Bolívar, the Constitution of Barcelona, that was the slogan of recuperación or recovery or reconstruction. Well, this another very interesting issue here. And the very known this project of regeneration of the waterfront can be also seen from those two perspectives, the subterranean reformist perspective and the formal qualitative morphological perspective, because it involves both social and economic dimension and morphology ones with these projects. The regeneration and also the recovery of the not exactly the urban block of the Cerdà in Sánchez, but yes, the urban block, the perimeter block, inspired Barcelona, but also in Amsterdam at the beginnings of the 20th century. It's another issue that is parallel to the emergence of new strategic projects after the Olympic Games, that can also be seen as a continuity of urban planning concepts. In fact, this is an important series of books and technical documents which prove this from the beginnings of the 1980s up until now. There are a series of technical documents who show this continuity. International debate about great events, Olympics and Expos, Barcelona, of course, has been seen as a model. As a model, and the famous Barcelona model was a very important out of Barcelona. But it's obvious that the Olympics were a turning point, and especially a catalyst of many other urban plans and projects. Some books like John Ball, and we have been working with some people very specialized in this kind of issue, but in urban history, architectural history, and the role of events, Olympic, Expos, etc. And there's a wide consensus about the impact of those great events, even ways, in urban form and structures. There's a slogan that says, when a city hosts the Olympic Games or International Expo, it will never be the same again. Of course, this is debatable, but it seems clear that Barcelona experienced a deep transformation since the beginning of the 1990s with the help of the Olympic Games. And just to finish, some references to the case of Zaragoza as a medium-sized city which has also experienced important urban changes in the last years. If we look at the maps, we will see the last 5 decades. So since the Valladolid exhibition, the last 50 years, from the 1978 to 2019. And, the plan of 1968 was the finished takeoff for a metropolitan structure. And then there was a plan of a similar of inspired, if you want, on the Madrid plan, 1985-86, essential for providing new facilities, services, open spaces to the neighborhoods thanks to this plan, together with the input of the Socialist Council, several actions were implemented: more control of urban growth, building new facilities, preservation of natural surroundings, improving urban spaces, historical centers, etc., as happened in Madrid and other cities. That plan was approved just when the economic cycle changed in the middle of the 1980s. So there were revisions and finally a new plan approved in 2002. But this plan also presents really with strategic projects that were changing urban structures and forms. In this case, the high-speed station, railway spaces, the river regeneration, developing parallel with the international expo. We worked as catalysts of other urban projects. During these years, just to give some data, there was a spectacular growth, but not in population, which reached about 700,000 inhabitants, but with the new urban land uses. Just to give just one data, urban expansion has almost doubled in only 50 years, from 1995 to 2010, that is from about 6,000 hectares to almost about 10,000 hectares now. Of course, this has to do with the last housing bubble, but also with expansion of industrial uses, as you can see, growing four times in the same period. So it's important to say that the plan had also emphasized our intervention of the old city center and the inner peripheries. Several areas have been subject of urban regeneration. Even the crisis of 2008 led to stop the most ambitious one. Regarding strategic urban projects associated to the expo, it should be said that they were not the result of the plan, but instead they were approved with always extraordinary tools, such as the accompanying plan or other plans or programs for urban intervention. Despite the focus on the expo site that occupied only 25 hectares, on land, the impact of open space was more than this. Just to give another data, the system of green spaces grew from 2,000 to almost 5,000 hectares. So more than double. It's another spectacular data, not taking into account, and on the others of new residential and industrial uses, land uses. However, the most important legacy was the quality, not the quantity, of open spaces. And this was again a product of this extraordinary context, where the conventional and sectoral approaches were overcome in a way. And with this in mind, we can finish making some reference to the new urban instruments that are out of conventional zoning plans. That's the case, for instance, of the Green Infrastructure Master Plan, which is very important now, or the Urban Regeneration Master Plans, or other ways of urban intervention, different or parallel to the Master Plan, which is not so a protagonist now. So, so some works and explorations and proposals made with our department in the university, works published after working in the last 7 years with master workshops with this kind of new instruments of energy. And just to finish, reference to Mario Gaviria. Was very interested in all this process, and where we were collaborating since the end of the 70s, and then in the 90s, and then at the end of this process, and last year there was this commerce to put the name of Mario Gaviria on one of his streets by the riverfront. It was very interesting to see how Mario Gaviria was looking to both the quality of the urban spaces, of course, the what we call now the ecological urban, the designing with nature, but at the same time interested in this strategy part. And
always with this general idea. First, there's in this interview in the 1970s in the Spanish TV, was very interesting. And then, in the last one of the last interventions in the following in Madrid, and he says, first one. First of all, my true vocation will be that people can live by working little and living well. All my colleagues time will be able to achieve and comfort of society, that I must spend a lot of energy, that I must study much, that I must listen, spoil each other, and this is quite a moment, it's a dream. This is, for some, is a paradox that this sort of view that could be progressive in the terms of the Franchassoel classification of this dual tradition of urban progressive and culturalist. I think very less both. Because there are a lot of paradoxes, a lot of failures, and some successes in the story of Spanish urban planning, urban design, and urbanism. Yes. Late, but just to say that when Peter Hall said the City of Towers, the Gorsian legacy, Peter Hall claimed that the final irony is that in cities all over the world, this was condemned as a failure of planning. He said, planning is just what it was not. So, and people say, the failure of the City of Towers. He says, that was not the failure because was, we can say, the relative failure of modernist urban design. Second, regarding failure of success, regarding the impact of recent urban planning, Terán said not in this book, but recently in a lecture, he said that you cannot speak of great success, but never of great failure of urban urbanism, since it has contributed decisively for good to contribute many parts of the city in the last half century. But I think it's a bit generic, it's too generic for planning historians. And we could say that Spanish urban planning has experienced a great positive shift from this sad story of urban planning in the beginning of the century up to now. And then the concept of urbanism, even is in this last book, Peter Hall was making a tour on Europe, and he says that British should learn from European cities, of course, continental European cities, before the Brexit. He says and it was the concept of urbanism, it was then in Montpellier, in France. The concept of urbanism supposed to planification to French is essentially about creating livable places. And then Michael Herr said the triumph of urbanism over conventional planning and with the Royal Town Planning Institute acceptance that making place and creating space are at the heart of town planning. So according to this view, the commitment to quality urbanism will be an important contribution to some Spanish urban plans and families to commercial planning culture. And then, regarding the role of state urban projects, Nuno Porta said, almost all the main successful urban transformation adopted and implemented in the last two decades, he was talking in 2004, so in the 1980s and 1990s, he says, disregard or even oppose the master plan in place, and although the outcome was often good, it was not always the case. So, this urban project would be more important than general master plans. And the subject of planning history should be broader and more complex, including other planning stories. And just 30 seconds, because it's right. So, the final irony, or another irony, and paradox, I would say that is that the progressive and reformist planning, so the plans of the 1980s, and some of the recent ones, the plans and projects, converge again with the morphologist and quality urbanists. And I guess François Chauvet would see this as a new wave, a new cycle of culturalist urbanism. Of course, I'm talking about the good city plans and urban projects, not the technocratic plans or low quality urban projects.